Today we will be making this, this, and even this inside of Blender and combining them all to get this. Complex materials made without complexity. Here are three of my go-to methods I use all the time to not make my materials look boring. And I also share some resources to level up your texturing skills quickly. Let's jump right in. So this is the scene we are going to be recreating today. And this is the node setup for this material. Don't get overwhelmed, I'm going to delete all this and start from scratch. So let's start with only a principal BSPF. It's going to be a plain black material. But right now there is not much detail in it. And that is where these texture maps come in. I'm going to show you where to download it and how to download it in a moment. For this, I'm going to drag and drop this .02 texture into Blender. Let's preview that. And this is how it looks. And because this is a UV unwrapped model, it is being projected properly. But let's say if this model wasn't UV projected, I could hit Ctrl T, set this to object and this to box. I'm going to make the texture a bit more bigger and I would just increase the blend value. That is what I would do. And since this model is UV unwrapped, I'm going to stick with UV unwrapped. And the only time where the object coordinate and box projection doesn't work is if you are working with a pattern. If it's any other PBR textures, 99% of the time you can get away without UV unwrapping by using box projection. So let's set this to flat. So by default it is going to use UV unwrapping. Instead of setting color space to sRGB, you have to set this to non-color. And it is best practice to do that with everything that doesn't have color data in it. And if I plug this into our roughness and let's preview our principal BSPF, you can see that we have some roughness details in here. But I'm not going to use this as roughness for now. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to plug this into our base color. Let's delete this. I'm going to add a color ramp and I'm going to pick whatever color I want. Going to go for a yellowish color, copy that color over here and make this a bit darker. And just like that, instead of having a plain texture, we have some subtle details in it. And if I want the details to have a harder fall off, I could crank the values in here and make the fall off a bit more sharper. That is looking good. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add another scratches texture and set this to non-color as well and plug this into our roughness. Let's see what happens. What is happening when we plug this texture into our roughness is wherever it is black, it is getting a zero value and wherever it is white, it is getting a value of one. If you really want to understand how it works, I would definitely recommend you watching this video. In that tutorial, I visually show you how things work. So if I plug this into our roughness, you can see we are getting a bit more variation in the lighting as well. Like without this, you can see the lighting is completely flat. But if I plug this into the roughness, because there is a variation in the roughness, we are also getting a variation in the light reflected as well. And if I feel like I want the fall off to be much harder, again, we can add a color ramp, plug it in here and crush the dark and bright values. Okay, that is looking pretty good. And we can keep on adding more and more layers over this. What I mean by that is if I'm going to take another one, set this to non-color as well. Let's preview it. Okay, that is how it looks. If I take another mix color, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this as a mask. I'm going to plug that into factor and plug this into color A. I'm going to add a color ramp over here to make the fall off between these colors a bit more sharper. So what happened is, this is how it looked before. And with this, we are adding another layer of detail. And again, I can come in here, play with the fall off a little bit, maybe make it a lot sharper. And maybe I could even take one of these scratches. Let's drag and drop it over here. Going to take another principal BSDF, and this time I want it to be metallic. And what I want to do is, I want to use these scratches to mask between these two materials. Ctrl Shift, right mouse button and drag between these two nodes, which gives me a mix shader. Let's preview our mix shader and plug in our scratches into our mix shader. I want the fall off to be sharper. So whenever you want to edit the fall off of a mask, you always use a color ramp. Plug it in here and let's crush the values. Preview this. And with that one more added level of detail, we have some metallic scratches on the material as well. And using texture maps like this is an extremely easy way to create complex looking material without much complexity. To download the Surface imperfections I showed you earlier, you can go to the link in the description and you have to sign into ArtStation to download this. And then this page opens up and you can hit download. A huge shout out to Emil for making this freely available to all of us. And now for method 2. In this one, I'm going to show you how to use procedural system to create some surface imperfections for us. I usually prefer this method when I am looking for something very simple, like let's say a simple color variation or a simple bump. I usually stick with the procedural method. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add a Musgrave texture. Let's preview it. And for all the Redshift users out there, I'm quickly going to show you how the same thing works in Redshift as well. And inside of Redshift, if I drag and drop one of these image textures, I can come over here into our color space. And here in File IO, I have to set this to Raw. This is equivalent to the non-color inside of Blender. And when I plug something in here and I want to change the falloff of something, I'm going to use a ramp. So it's basically the same thing. And for our Mix RGB node we have, in Redshift, we have color mix. It's the same thing. It has the same inputs and it works the same way. The only thing is inside of Blender, for 0 it was black and for 1 it was white. In Redshift, it is the opposite. For 0 it's white and for 1 it's black. Everything else, it's the same. And now let's continue with our procedural way of doing this. And right now you can see and we have our Musgrave texture over here. And whenever you are using a procedural texture, always use object coordinate. That is going to give you the best results. I'm going to scale this. And I'm going to plug this into our base color and use a color ramp and change the colors. Earlier with the image textures, what we did was we recreated this part with an image texture. But while using procedural textures, we have to create all those details procedurally. So right now you can see this. This looks extremely flat. It is only a one texture, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy this. Let's preview that. I'm going to scale it down. Mix these two together. Let's preview that and set this to multiply. And that is much more detailed. And as you can see right now, even though it is just two colors, from black to a dark gray color, it is adding that little bit of detail. And if I want to, I could add a bump to this. Plug this into height, normal into normal. It is going to give us bump as well. I'm going to scale it down. And that is looking much better. Over here, it was super flat. And over here, it has much more detail in it. So this would be a procedural way to do this. And of course, we could keep adding things into this. Like, let's take a Warner texture. Let's use the same mapping. Distance to edge to get this kind of pattern. Scale this up. I'm going to add a noise texture over here to break this much even more. If you are interested in learning how procedural texturing works, I have a full-fledged course on it. So definitely check that out if this is something that interests you. The procedural side of Blender. I'm going to use this as lines. Right now you can see we have little cracks in it. And what I want to do is I want these little cracks to have a bit more darker color. So what will I do? I will take a Mix RGB or a Mix color as it is known right now. Plug this into A. It should be into B. Yeah, okay. And I'm going to select a dark color or maybe a light color again. Yeah, I think a light color would work. Plug this into base color, preview it. And you can see we have that cracks a bit more defined. And like we can make it any color actually. But if you are making simple plain materials, I would definitely recommend you add these little color variations, bump variations and things like that into it. And now for method number 3, which is my preferred method, which is a mixture of our method 1 and method 2. Let me show you some examples of how I use this in some of my projects. And one way I really like to use this method is I would create a material procedurally. And I would use the surface imperfections to add bump to this. Whenever there is some kind of imperfection in a material, it looks way better. Like even if it is a subtle bump. And this would be a direct comparison between these two. Which one looks better? I think the answer is obvious. Like this is an animation I'm doing currently. Like you can see in the wood, we have the scratches. Well, that doesn't come with the PBR. The PBR is only the wood texture. I added this extra level of imperfection and to recreate this, I would use a Mix RGB, plug the surface imperfection into the fact value and do what we did in the first method to add some color variations to it. And over here as well, you can see there is a roughness variation and a bit of color variation to it as well. Thanks for watching till the end. follow for more Blender stuff.